Sonic the Hedgehog on Genesis has always and will always be an important game in history. So much life and creativity is jam-packed into this one game, which led to everyone and their mom trying to make a Sonic game, but that original game could never be touched.
Sonic the Hedgehog runs, jumps, moves, and spins at supersonic speed. And now, he's loose.
You turn on Sonic 1 and you go like,
alright, yeah!
And you jump straight into Green Hill Zone. No need for a boring opening cutscene or clunky menus. Everything you need to know about the story and gameplay can be explained by the very beginning of the first level, an open area that introduces you to the fundamentals of the game to slowly ease you into the gameplay. Collecting rings, jumping or rolling into enemies, and destroying item monitors to gain rewards. All this while slowly establishing what sets Sonic apart from Mario, momentum. There is no run button, and as much as people say that speed is the most important mechanic of a Sonic game, that's just a reward for understanding how to manipulate Sonic's momentum correctly. The slow buildup of slopes and hills gets you ready for the big test, your first loop-de-loop. You need just enough momentum to make it through the entire loop, which leads you to experiment to figure out how to gain more speed. And as the level progresses, areas where you actually have to start platforming become more frequent. Just holding right and making it to the end of the stage is no longer an option. All of these mechanics about momentum, Sonic's moveset, are taught with zero text boxes. No annoying dialogue that treats you like a child. It's something that could be taught without words, which is something that many games forget that they're allowed to do nowadays. It may have just been a limitation of the time, but the lack of a proper tutorial in a modern sense led them to baking that tutorial straight into the level geometry. The main benefit of this is the pick-up-and-play nature that this creates. Replayability is a main draw of Sonic because of that need to get better, to beat the level faster. I would find it very hard to believe that Green Hill Zone and Sonic as a whole would be as iconic to gaming as it is if the game didn't drop you straight into the action to let you loose to have fun. Just a few years later, Sonic 2 launched and blew expectations out of the water. This game improved on that initial title in so many different ways. More iconic zones, characters, improved controls, and new moves for Sonic to perform, all while staying faithful to Sonic 1. This is the game that made Sonic, Sonic. Sonic 2, I believe, is the sole reason this franchise lasted past the Genesis. This game expanded on everything Sonic 1 established with more long-lasting series staples than 1 ever did. While Green Hill Zone is iconic, the rest of the stages in Sonic 1 come nowhere close to the wonderfully varied and themed levels from 2. Casino Night, Chemical Plant, Hilltop, Mystic Cave Zone. While this game did have its fair share of duds, it more than makes up for it with how consistently jaw-dropping these stages are. This game introduces so many series mainstays like the Spin Dash, Super Sonic, Tails, 3D Special Stages, and Robotnik's Death Egg. This game is a perfect sequel in every right, and right before Sonic 3 & Knuckles was about to set a new series high with its overhauled visuals and gameplay, we got a sequel to Sonic the Hedgehog. Again. Sonic CD. Sonic CD is a game that got its identity of the sequel to Sonic the Hedgehog, stolen by Sonic 2. It's this weird alternate reality version of what another sequel to the same game would be like. It's very much the lost levels of Sonic in that respect. A sequel to a game with more faithful design and feel to the original, which was overshadowed by another sequel that was more iconic and had a longer lasting impact on the series as a whole. Both Sonic 2 and Sonic CD were developed around the same time. With the team from the first game getting split up, Sonic's creator Yuji Naka headed the development of Sonic 2 in America with STI, or Sega Technical Institute, while the art director behind Sonic 1, Naoto Oshima, was leading the production of an enhanced port of Sonic 2 for the Sega Genesis add-on, the Sega CD. Over time, it began to take shape as its own separate game to help sell the Sega CD. New ideas and inspiration struck him to develop an experience unlike Sonic 2. And to say that Sonic CD feels like a mere expansion of Sonic 1 would be doing the game an incredible disservice. Ideas and new concepts did clash between CD and Sonic 2. The Spin Dash and the Super Peel Out, Mecha Sonic and Metal Sonic, 3D Special Stages, all these approaches with the same intent that end up entirely different. So many new ideas were brought to the series, only for them to be shelved right after release. Metal Sonic and Amy Rose were introduced in this game, who are the only remnants of Sonic CD in modern Sonic media. Metal Sonic has the slickest design out of any character in this series, and purely really lives off his coolness factor. Mecha Sonic cannot hold a candle to how good this design is. He is the most threatening looking villain in the series. He doesn't need to look dark and edgy, he just nails what he's trying to be, an actual rival to Sonic. Amy Rose became such a major part of the group's dynamics between Sonic and company, so much so that writing her out of the series at this point would be nearly impossible. The story for this game is shown in one short and beautifully animated cutscene. Nothing overly complicated is shoved down your throat at the very start. All this is meant to do is to set the stage for the world that you will be exploring. Sonic games tend to have trouble with engaging stories. Either it's written like a lame Saturday morning cartoon, or it's a confusing mess.
The story in a Sonic game is a lot like making an omelet. Sometimes Sega just goes, here kid, take this. Sometimes Sega takes the story too seriously. It either comes off as incoherent or just confusing. And sometimes Sega just says, fuck you.
Sonic CD is a bit more complex in the story department, which is something that I enjoy out of a Sonic game, dabbling into time travel and including multiple endings. It gives it a different identity compared to the other Genesis games. Everything else is told through gameplay, and a short in-game appearance by Amy and Metal. Their introductory scene in Collision Chaos is perfectly integrated into the level, to where it introduces Sonic's motivations and gives the player a goal to work towards, being save Amy from Metal Sonic. And the other huge part of this game is traveling through time to stop Robotnik from roboticizing Little Planet, the place where Sonic finds himself at the very beginning of the game. It's all up to the player to choose if they'd like to save Little Planet or not. Sure, you'll get stuck with the bad ending if you don't do anything, but you're able to experience the entirety of the game without traveling in time once or destroying a single robot transporter. This sort of immersive storytelling from an early 90s Sonic title is insane, and the amount of player choice is incredible. The game definitely sets itself apart with its art direction. While Sonic 2 wanted to show the player more of a glimpse into Sonic's world, Sonic CD was allowed to express itself by having this very unique and distinct world full of all different shapes and colors without limits. There's very little cohesion between the locations in Sonic CD, which does lead to a bit less of memorability. The stages lack proper theming, even in the future and past versions of the zones. A lot of shapes and colors feel thrown onto the screen without purpose. In comparing Sonic stages, I say Spring Yard Zone and Casino Night, while still having a bunch of bright colors and random seeming spring and object locations, are much more cohesive than a stage like Collision Chaos in Sonic CD. Although it still has that classic Sonic trope of having all the levels get more mechanical theme as you get closer and closer to Eggman's base. Aside from that, the locales you visit feel random and unimportant. It's a lot more fluid with its levels and art direction, but that's something I learned to love about this game. It's an acquired taste, sort of like alcohol. The power of the Sega CD is really showcased through the wide and vast vistas the player inhabits. There's so much color on the screen at a given time that I have to take a second to take it all in. The detailed environments and the vibe the game gives off puts it in a league of its own, but the game's true claim to fame is the time travel mechanic. Four different versions of each act of each zone. This was and still is one of the most ambitious mechanics for a Sonic game that ever made it into the final release. All you do is run past the signpost and either travel to the past or the future, while the challenge is to keep your speed while the level deliberately tries to stop you. Many people complain about the level design of this game. It feels as though everything is placed randomly, and it's too hard to find a place to gain speed with so much stuff in the way. And to that I have to agree. I think that the game doesn't feel like its levels were made for a Sonic game. It feels like the game is designed to fight against you to use your speed, but that's kind of the point. Other Sonic games try to put stuff in your way to make it fun to dodge and avoid obstacles while keeping your momentum. Sonic CD is no different, but it has more of a reason to want to stop the player. The game without going for the good ending is very easy to do, but actually trying to go for everything in the game is where they added the challenge. More than any other Sonic game, this game promotes exploration in its levels. Each stage features one hidden Metal Sonic projection, one of Robotnik's robot transporters that you need to destroy, along with gathering 50 rings before the end of the stage to go into a special stage to get a time stone. Beating the game while actively avoiding these features and playing it like a normal Sonic game is not the way to go about this game. The game could be beaten in less than half an hour if you're not paying attention to the time stones or robot transporters, but in doing this you'll be robbing yourself from a better experience. Sonic games will always be better on replay. My first playthroughs of Mania and 3 were not super enjoyable to me because I was too worried about finding the big rings and getting the Chaos Emeralds, but after you learn all their locations, your second playthrough will be you scrambling to get all the Chaos Emeralds in the first zones, and then you'll be able to experience the rest of the game how it should be played. Sega originally putting this game on the Sega CD with no save feature really did this game a disservice, because all the goals for each act makes this game way more fun to pick up and play, rather than trying to do it all in one sitting. When Sega finally re-released Sonic CD and put it on mobile, I believe a lot more players experienced Sonic Sonic CD the way it was meant to be played. In comparison, when Nintendo designs a game for one of their handheld consoles, they make a game that specializes in smaller, shorter challenges, so you can play for a bit, put it down, but still feel accomplished. Sonic CD's structure of exploration-based platforming makes for the perfect experience for portable on-the-go gaming. Sonic 3 and Mania did tap into this feeling of exploration rather than just zooming through the levels all the time, but you have to give credit where credit is due to Sonic CD. Sonic CD's music will always be everyone's favorite part of this game. Two entirely different soundtracks for North America and Japan, both with absolute bangers of songs. And guess what? Four different versions of levels means four different arrangements of each level's music. Palm Tree Panic has that first Sonic level flair, but you get into Tidal Tempest, with this music that starts with echoing inside an underground cave that slowly turns into a funky atmospheric jam that'll be stuck in your head for days. With the obvious crown jewel of this game being Stardust Speedway, which has the best level design that feels way more at home in a Sonic game, with the most loops out of any stage in the game, one of the most enjoyable Sonic bosses from this generation, all to the best music tracks in the game in both the US and Japanese soundtracks. Sonic CD will be a game that grows on you. What I used to despise about this game is now why I enjoy it so much. This feels like a game where the creative team behind it went insane with ideas and the programmers just fueled their creativity with more ideas. It separates itself from the typical Sonic formula, but still feels at home with the other games, all while still standing on its own as a fun side story to the main games. This game didn't get the love it deserved in its initial run, but now can be appreciated as the game it was always meant to be. I definitely don't think it should be the highest rated Sonic game on Metacritic. Like, what the fuck? But this game is definitely worth your time if you're willing to put in the effort to see it all the way through.